Last time we talked about how to solve related rates problems. Today we're going to be talking about another very common application of derivatives, optimization. This will be the last application we cover before moving on to integrals, where we'll answer the second fundamental question of calculus, how to find the area underneath a curve. Optimization is all about finding the extremes of a function. Basically, you're looking for the largest and smallest values that a function attains on a given range. These kinds of points are called the function's extrema, but you'll also hear specific points referred to as local or global maxima and local or global minima. We've already mentioned extrema and maxima and minima, which might not be terms we're familiar with. Let's visualize what we mean for a second by looking at the graph of this function. Let's pretend we were asked to find the extrema of this function on the range x equals negative 2 to x equals 2. On this range, we can see that the function is at its highest at x equals 2, and at its lowest at x equals negative 2. Because the function is higher at x equals 2 than anywhere else, you can say that x equals 2 is its global maximum on this range. Similarly, because the function is lower at x equals negative 2 than anywhere else, you can say that x equals negative 2 is the global minimum. Keep in mind that the highest and lowest points on a range are not the only points we're interested in. We also care about points that are the highest or lowest points in the neighborhood of points around them. For example, this point here is a local minimum because it is the lowest point in the immediate vicinity. In the same way, this point is a local maximum because it is the highest point in the immediate vicinity. Now that we have a visual idea of what we're looking for, here's a summary of the steps you'll follow to figure out the largest and smallest values a graph attains in a given range. Let's go through these in more detail by trying them out on the function we looked at earlier. First, we'll take the derivative of the original function, then set the derivative equal to 0 and solve for x. The solutions are the function's critical points. Critical points are potential points of extrema. We can't say yet for sure whether the critical points represent local or global maximums, local or global minimums, or none of the above. We have to test them to find out. To test them, we have to plot them on a number line. Then we'll pick one value on the number line to the left of the leftmost critical point, one value to the right of the rightmost critical point, and one value between every critical point. Each of these in-between points will represent the behavior of the graph on that range. In other words, negative 2 will tell us the behavior of the graph from negative infinity to negative 1. 0 will represent what the graph does between negative 1 and 1/3, and 1 will tell us what the graph is doing between 1/3 and positive infinity. Now we'll plug the test values into the derivative we found earlier. When we get a positive answer, we know that the function increases on that test point's range. If we get a negative answer, then we know that the function decreases on the range that the test point represents. As we use each of the test values to test each range, we'll indicate the result on the number line with a direction arrow that gives us a visual representation of the results. The direction arrow indicates the direction of the graph, so they represent a very rough picture of what the graph looks like, which means we can see from the direction arrows that this point is a maximum and this one is a minimum. Now we know that we have a maximum and a minimum, but we still don't know whether these points are local extrema or global extrema. To find out, we have to plug each of the critical points and the endpoints of the range into the original function. Doing so will tell us the function's actual value at these points, and we'll be able to compare all of them to see which are the highest and lowest. When we plug the critical points and the endpoints into the original function, we get the actual values of the function at those points, and we can see that the function is highest at x equals 2, which makes it the global maximum. The function is lowest at x equals negative 2, which makes it the global minimum. That means that we're left with x equals negative 1 as the local maximum, and x equals 1/3 as the local minimum. Now that we've covered the basics of optimization, let's turn to applied optimization to see how this tool could be used in the real world. We're going to review a commonly studied real-world example, but first, let's talk about the steps you'll follow to solve an applied optimization problem. Generally, the steps you'll follow to solve an applied optimization problem are 1. Write down everything you've been given and exactly what you need to find. 2. Set up your equations, one for the constraint and the other to optimize. 3. Solve the constraint equation for one of the variables so that you can plug it into the optimization equation. 4. After plugging into the optimization equation from the constraint equation, take the derivative of the optimization equation to find your critical point. Keep in mind that there may be a second critical point that you have to eliminate. 5. Finally, make sure to answer the question you were really asked. You can use the first or second derivative test to double-check yourself and ensure that you minimized or maximized appropriately. Let's work through a common example. Here's the problem. You need to build an open-topped rectangular box that has a volume of 972 cubic inches. The bottom of the box must be twice as long as it is wide, and you're asked to find the dimensions of the box that will minimize its surface area. The first thing to do is to draw a picture of our open-topped box. It's always best to draw a picture of what we're dealing with. We know that the length is twice the width, so we can call the length 2x and the width x. We also know that the volume is 972 cubic inches. Since we've been asked to find the dimensions that minimize surface area, we know that the equation we're going to optimize will be an equation for the surface area of the box. The constraint equation will be an equation involving the volume of the box and its dimensions, since those are the constraints within which we've been asked to work. If we call the unknown height h, then we can write the constraint equation as 972 equals 2x times x times h, because we know that the equation for the volume of a box is length times width times height. The optimization equation for the surface area is a equals xh plus xh for the two ends, plus 2xh plus 2xh for the two long sides, plus 2x squared for the bottom. We need to get our optimization area equation down to one variable, which means we have to plug in for h. We can manipulate the constraint equation to find that h is 972 over 2x squared, or 486 over x squared. Now we can take this value for h and plug it into the optimization equation. We can start to calculate critical points by taking the derivative of our optimization equation, setting that equal to 0, and solving for x. We find that our critical points are x equals 0 and x equals 9. Because we're talking about the dimensions of a box, we know that x equals 0 cannot be a solution, so x equals 9 is our only valid critical point. Since x equals 9, we can calculate the dimensions as 9 by 18 by 6. To ensure that we found the correct dimensions, we can confirm that x equals 9 is in fact a local minimum of our function. Using the same process we used in the last example, we can plot x equals 9 on our number line, then pick values on either side of it, like 8 and 10. We'll plug 8 into the first derivative of our optimization equation to find that it's negative. Then we'll plug 10 into the first derivative of our optimization equation to find that it's positive. The negative, then positive pattern indicates that 9 is a local minimum of the function, which means that a critical point of x equals 9 and dimensions of 9 by 18 by 6 do in fact minimize the surface area. Hopefully that gives you a clearer picture of how to deal with optimization problems and their applications. Next time, we'll start talking about integrals, and we'll answer the second fundamental question of calculus, how to find the area beneath a curve. I'll see you then. Click on a video for a more in-depth look at the topics covered. Review this video by clicking the links on the right, and subscribe to be notified of future videos.